All right, well, good afternoon, everyone. Welcome to another training for United Way 211, put on by Call for Justice. We have a great speaker today, Debra Swaden, who I'll introduce in a second. I just wanted to welcome you, and our topic today is family law. Let me introduce Debra, and we will go from here. Debra Swaden is the supervising attorney at the 4th District Court Self-Help Centers. She received her BA from the University of Wisconsin in 1976 and her law degree from Lewis and Clark Law School in 1979. She's worked in the legal department of Federal Land Bank of St. Paul and LifeWork Services, a division of Ceridian, where she was a senior manager. She was also the co-developer and co-owner, just by happenstance, of a bagel bakery and cafe now known as Einstein Brothers Bagels. Debra has worked for the 4th Judicial District Court since 2002 and has been a supervisor of the Self-Help Center since 2004. She is a member of the Board of Directors at Volunteered Lawyers Network and is admitted to practice in Wisconsin and Minnesota. She's been a wonderful supporter of Call for Justice. She's well familiar with work that United Way 211 does, and I know very much respectful of what great work you do. And so help me welcome Debra Swaden to talk about our first installment of family law.
Well, thanks, everyone. It is a special pleasure to be here because, yes, I did used to work for Ceridian, and three of my former coworkers are sitting here, and I just can't stop beaming because I'm so happy to see them, and it's been 10 years. So they haven't changed at all, and I've gotten a little shorter, but they seem to recognize me too. So I also, as Ellie said, I'm a big admirer of the work that you all do, and at the Court Self-Help Center, we refer to you all the time. So I'm hoping that those referrals are coming the other way as well, and we're going to talk a little bit today mostly about family law in general. And come on in, please. Okay. Family law in general, and then a little bit about the self-help centers and how it might be useful as a referral for your callers. So, I'm going to start, as I said, by talking about family law in general. I'm just going to move that cord a little bit. We'll start with the concept of really what is family law. It really is a way to resolve issues that arise between married parties as they separate or divorce, and for all parties who are parents. Increasingly in our society, as you all know, and it's been just really astounding at the court, the kinds of cases that increase the most are paternity-related cases, because more and more folks are having children without being married, and so those the issues having to do with the kids, which generally are custody, child support, parenting time, which some people refer to as visitation, and establishment of paternity itself, those are all issues that come to the family court. The whole concept of family law, when there are children involved, really is focused on the best interests of the child or children. And so we're going to talk about a few different areas where the law makes certain presumptions, or some things might seem to be more difficult for the parents, but the purpose of all of that is to make sure that those kids, that their best interests are the primary and biggest priority being dealt with by the court. Adults have to, we're expected to adapt to our changing situations a little more, in a little more mature process, which sometimes doesn't happen. So we'll start with paternity and understanding what that means as a beginning point here. Paternity generally, you know, refers, a general definition is that it is whoever is the father of a child. The legal definition of paternity means whoever is the legal father of the child, which may or may not be the biological father of the child. You know, certainly we know when there's an adoption or a termination of parental rights and then an adoption that the father of the child, the legal father of the child, is not the biological father. There are other times when that happens as well. But lots of people have misperceptions about what creates the legal father. And so when people are hopefully happy having a child and they're at the hospital, if dad's name is on the birth certificate, lots of people say, well, then that means they are the legal father. And if they are married, if it's a married couple having a child, then yes, that person is considered the legal father. But if they are not married, just having the birth certificate, the name on the birth certificate, does not create that legal relationship. It's a start, but it doesn't create it. In Minnesota and in many states, there is a procedure for people to voluntarily become the legal father. And here we call it a recognition of parentage, sometimes referred to as a ROPE, R-O-P. It's a form that the parents complete and that they both say, yes, you know, George over here is the father of this newborn or of this child. And that recognition of parentage, in order to make George be the legal father, means that that recognition of parentage has to be filed with the Department of Health in Minnesota. Lots of other states have similar procedures. If there isn't a voluntary establishment, either one or both of the parties isn't entirely sure who is the biological father or who should be become the legal father, there are procedures for genetic testing that can, you know, as technology has improved in that, can very clearly determine who is or is not the father. And it involves, you know, blood tests from the father and the child. Excuse me. So if someone isn't sure if they're the father and they want to make sure, they can ask for that genetic testing. If mom is sure, but dad isn't sure, that can happen. And there are situations when mom isn't sure either. And so there might be more than one person who goes through that genetic testing to determine who, in fact, should be established as the legal father. People who do that recognition of parentage form, they voluntarily say, yep, I'm the dad. She says, yep, he's the dad. Part of that process is waiving that right to genetic testing. So if you ever have callers who are wondering, you know, I'm just not sure, and I've been asked to sign this, and I'm just not sure, it's important that they do understand that, you know, if they do sign it, they are waiving that right to genetic testing. Not to say there's no circumstances, you know, in which that could be sort of reopened, but it's much more difficult. So people should be pretty sure before they volunteer for that. As I said, there are some legal presumptions about who is the father of the child. Again, focused on the idea that every child deserves to have two people who are, at least two people, who are responsible for him or her. And so if people are married to each other and a child is born during the marriage, that child is presumed to be a child of that married couple. And we know, pretty much every day at the Family Justice Center Self-Help Center that presumption is not always correct. You know, lots of people who separate and they might be, you know, have not done anything about getting divorced. They're married, they've separated and been for 10 or 20 years and have other children. Well, unless they take steps to have the father, the biological father, step forward and say, I am the father, and the husband to say, I am not the father, unless those two things are done, the presumption is that the child is the child of the husband, even if those parties haven't been together for quite a long time. Of course, we also have situations where parties are still together and a child is born that is not the husband's child. And again, if there's someone to step up to it and there are people who are, and the husband is saying, nope, not my kid, then that's the easiest way for this to happen. But that doesn't always happen. Sometimes it's a surprise to the husband. You know, sometimes he's been acting as the child's father, and all of a sudden, kind of a rude surprise, guess what? You never were the child's father biologically, but from a legal standpoint, in fact, that person is the father. So, you know, any kind of permutation you can think of on relationships and what happens is all real. I mean, it all happens. So I'm probably not telling you guys anything you don't know. And from the court perspective, there have to be ways for dealing with all of these situations. So it can get quite complicated. So any questions that anyone has about that topic, about paternity or who might be the legal father, I'd be happy to answer.
Please, as our usual course is, jump in and ask questions at any point. Debra's very adept at answering.
Well, I'm happy to answer them as they occur to you. Excuse me. So, well, what happens when someone is the legal father? What rights do they have that they would not necessarily have if they were not the legal father? Well, the things we all think about are custody, the right to be considered as possibly having custody of the child, and we'll talk a little bit more about that. Child support, you know, obligation to financially support the child until the child is 18 or through college oftentimes, parenting time, you know, the right to spend time with the child, used to be called visitation, but again, you know, we're trying to get more egalitarian, particularly in Minnesota is quite a progressive state in that, and so we don't have plaintiffs and defendants in these, we have petitioners and respondents, we have, it's, you know, trying to be less adversarial. And we don't, you know, a parent doesn't visit with their child. They have parenting time with their child. Just like, you know, a dad can't be the babysitter because how would you babysit your own child? I mean, that's just an aside there. But anyway, so those are the main rights and responsibilities that attach to becoming a parent and a mother. Who has a child automatically has that. If you've birthed a child, you automatically have the responsibility to financially support that child. And you, in Minnesota, a child born to a mother where there is no marriage and there hasn't been paternity established, it's presumed that the mother has full custody, and you know, all of the rights herself unless and until there's some other determination that someone also shares in that. Again, unless they're married, then they both have custody. So with any relationship, there are ups and downs, and so things happen where people do not see eye to eye, and whether they are married and feeling the need to get divorced, or they are not married but they are now separated, or they never really were together, but you know, now they have this shared joy and obligation in having a child. People aren't always able to resolve these issues themselves. And that's where traditionally family court has stepped in to be the place where people bring their disputes and they get resolved. Traditionally, that has been done by, I bring my evidence and that person brings their evidence and the judge makes a decision about what should be. And when you think about it, that might be good situation when we're deciding, you know, if I owe this person $1,000 or they owe me $1,000, because we could just part ways and, you know, one of us win and one of us lose and we never have to deal with each other again. But when you're dealing with, particularly where there's children involved, where things are going to, like it or not, you're going to continue to be involved in each other's lives, presenting all of this to a judge who's going to say, here's what's going to happen, you know, a stranger, doesn't make a lot of sense. And so over time, as society has gotten more evolved, and in Minnesota, again, quite a progressive state, there have been changes to that whole process. And so pretty much kind of incrementally, but every year, including this past year, requirements come in before going to family court to make sure that people are trying to settle these matters without someone dictating it to them. And the reason for that, again, it just makes much more sense for the people in the know about it to make decisions than to have a stranger decide for them. But it's also the case that people are happier with the results when they've had an opportunity to contribute to that, when they've been to mediation, when they've had to give a little, but they've also gotten a little. It's much more likely to end up in a more workable long-term solution than it is if, again, that black-robed person, you know, pointed and said, you do this and you do that. So at many steps of the process, people are going to be encouraged or required to go to mediation and or some other form of alternative dispute resolution. And mediation is the most common in family law, but there are others as well. And from the court perspective, you know, the court knows all this very well, because you sometimes, I mean, there are unfortunately families who, you know, have cases that go on for years and years. And, you know, the judge feels like he or she is, you know, is living with them because it's just so painful. And it just isn't the best way. So, you know, to the extent that when you're getting people calling and who are distressed about this, again, if you can help them reframe that, you know, if you can work this out between you, it's going to be a better result all the way around. But that doesn't always happen. So sometimes people do need to come to court. They do need an order from the court saying any number of things. So in a divorce situation, so where people have been married, the issues that they need to resolve are, even if they don't have children, there's a division of property, there's a division of the debts or liabilities, and in property, there can be, you know, the things that you normally think of. If there's a house, you know, how that's going to be divided, the mortgage that goes along with it, the personal property, the cars, the boats, the trailers, the, you know, the couch and the chair and all of that. But there's also other kinds of property that people don't always readily think about, like retirement accounts, you know, other sorts of investments that aren't really liquid, but there may be, you know, both parties may have interest in each other's. And if people, you know, make about the same amount of money and, are, you know, if everything is pretty equal, probably people can agree to divide things equally and people can go on their way and hopefully live a happier life thereafter. But sometimes they can't, and sometimes people have very protracted litigation about that division of property. In a divorce situation, there would also be the possibility of something called spousal maintenance, and that would be if there was a disparity in income or ability to earn income, oftentimes because one party has stayed home with the kids, or perhaps one party has worked while the other person was in a professional school and, you know, now has a much higher earnings potential than the other, that the, you know, to be equitable, to be fair, the court might order that one party is required to pay the other party some spousal maintenance. Sometimes people refer to it as alimony, that's sort of the, or spousal support. It could be for ever in some situations, particularly with long marriages where there's a big disparity. It could be that it's for a period of time, sort of a rehabilitative time. So let's say the person earning less is able to go back to school themselves and be able to, you know, increase their earning power. There could be triggers that would end it, like the remarriage of the person who was receiving the spousal support, or sometimes not even just marriage, but living with someone else, so again, having more of a shared income situation. You know, the idea here is to try to, as best as possible, keep people at the level, the quality of life that, you know, that they were used to. But we all know that when you've got income that's supporting one household and now it has to support two households, you're never going to, or you're rarely going to actually achieve that same, I'm missing the word that I want.
Parity.
Yeah, parity's good. So that's if you've got a divorce without children. Well, what if you have a divorce with children? Obviously, it gets a little more complicated. There's a whole other set of issues to deal with, and often these are the most emotional, the most difficult issues for people to come to agreement on. Custody is a big one. So there are two kinds of custody. There is physical custody, that is who has the child, where the child lives most of the time. And then there's legal custody, which is who has the right to make the really significant, important life decisions, which generally we think of as education, so where they're going to go to school, religious training, medical issues, medical decisions, those kinds of, you know, really the big ones that parents are charged with making for their child. So custody can be sole custody with one party, or can be joint, both parties. Joint legal custody is pretty much the norm in most situations. Unless there's some abuse or some other reason why one party should not be able to be involved in those big decisions, you know, we presume that it's best for the child if both parties are involved in that. So usually or often you will see a result where there is joint legal custody. Physical custody is a little more challenging. The concept of joint physical custody would be that both parties are spending roughly an equal amount of time with the child, which can mean that the child moves from one house to another, you know, on a regular schedule. I do know some situations where the child stays in the house and the parents move back and forth, so that, you know, the child has more stability and doesn't have to be going to two different places. Obviously, it depends on the parties as to what's going to work. And if the parties can't decide, you know, whether they should do A or B on any given day, you know, are they really going to be able to work out all of the issues with joint physical custody? So while there have been some attempts, and there was just this past year in the legislature, to make a presumption in Minnesota that all parties should have joint physical custody, there's a lot of controversy over that, and for good reason. You know, and in an ideal world, I think joint everything is great, but you know we don't live in an ideal world, and sometimes there is abuse, or sometimes there is a, you know, one party who's really got some issues that are not dealt with, whether it be chemical dependency or criminal issues or whatever, that wouldn't work out. And sometimes and again, remembering that the court is going to order what's in the child's best interest, you know, a child who has difficulty with a lot of change and needs some real stability, even if the parents, you know, could work it out, it might be best for the child to have one person have sole physical custody. So what goes along with that custody then is parenting time. So the concept, if you have joint physical custody, you don't really have parenting time because pretty much you're spending, you know, each party is spending half the time with the child. But where there isn't that, then you have to talk about parenting time. So how much parenting time is the other party going to have who does not have the sole physical custody? And are there circumstances where there might be special factors involved? So again, people can agree, depending on how well they get along, they can agree to reasonable parenting time. You know, and they just sort of work it out. Okay, so, you know, you pick up the child 2 days a week and, you know, spend the evening, and then every other weekend and holidays, there can be a schedule, or you know, we can just work it out. Reasonable visitation is not unusual. And for some people, that works for the rest of the child's childhood. For other people, they might start with reasonable and then parenting time is an area where there's a lot of friction. It's not working for me. Now I'm moving here and I can't get there, and you're making it hard for me and all of that. And so sometimes people will come back to court to ask for something called parenting time assistance. And this would apply whether this is a divorce or whether it's a paternity situation where then custody and parenting time, you know, has been established. Sometimes people need more help from the court to work that out. Again, the court's going to say, please, folks, try to work this out yourselves, and provides a number of tools for doing that. There are, we have in Hennepin County, in the 4th District, family court services, where there are mediators who can help people try to figure that out. There are parenting consultants, and sometimes the court will order people to hire a parenting consultant, and that parenting consultant will get to know the family, will, you know, get to know the child, and he or she will say what needs to be done. Sometimes the judge will say, you get a parenting consultant, and you do what the parenting consultant tells you to do. Okay, and so, because again, the judge who's got a bazillion other cases, you know, isn't going to be able to make decisions that are really in the best interests of the child. Or it's just much more difficult. So, child support, excuse me, also gets involved here because, and last year, maybe 2 years ago, 3 years ago, Minnesota changed its child support laws. So for many, many years, and in some other states still, it's based on a formula, you know, that it used to be that if you had one child, you could expect to pay, and you were not the custodial parent, you could expect to pay about 25% of your net income for child support. You know, and then it changes the more children you have. And a lot of people didn't think that was fair, because is that really looking at the particular situation? Are we taking enough factors, you know, into consideration here? And so now the child support calculation is based on the income of both parties, the custodial parent and the non-custodial parent, and the parenting time, the custody situation, and the parenting time. So it's a calculation, and there's actual calculator that you can link to through the court's website. And I didn't bring any more of those, but we're going to pass around a little bookmark that has the, or maybe some of you already have it, the court's website on it. And the Department of Human Services is the actual agency that made this calculator. But you can plug in all of these factors and then get an idea of how much child support you can expect to receive or pay, you know, depending on your situation. So,
And the link to it is on page 3.
And the link to it's on page 3. Thank you, Ellie. So, so that has gotten, I think, a lot fairer, but it's also more complicated to figure out because you do need to have a lot more information in order to do that.
Does that take into effect, someone else living in the home?
It can, yes. If there's someone else contributing to the household income, so the living expenses, mm-hmm. that's going to affect as well. That doesn't mean that person is obligated to pay child support for a child that isn't theirs, but it does mean that it would affect the parent in that household's ability to pay or not. So it, yes, it can include that.
A couple of them actually. One is in regards to the child support. Rarely do we hear about the support being from the mother paying it versus the mm-hmm. father. And does it really just come down to who has the custodial parentage or?
Exactly.
Okay, and then also, since someone that turns 18 is considered adult, what determines that the either parent that has that doesn't have the custodial aspect of having the child, that they continue to pay for anything after the child's 18?
It depends on the court order. Okay. And so if people are getting divorced, I mean, that's one thing that they need to be thinking about. You know, does this child, is it anticipated the child will go on to college or technical school or something? And, you know, there aren't laws that require parents to pay for that for their children, but most parents will, if they are able to, will try to help a child to do that. And so it needs to be brought up in front of the court in order for it to be ordered, required, you know, to continue after 18. It will almost always continue after 18 if the child is still in high school. So if you have a kid who turns 18 in September, doesn't mean the non-custodial parent is off the hook. I mean, if the child doesn't finish high school until the following spring.
So does that have to be determined at age 17 or at 18 or anything prior to?
Generally, if people are doing the right thing, they're going to be bringing it up before then. So typically in a divorce, that is something that does get brought up. In a establishment of custody and parenting time in a non-marriage situation, sometimes people forget about that, but they can go back, you know, if that hasn't been established, if there's been something about child support, then they can go back and re-raise that issue. If they've waived child support, or, and I should have said this about spousal support, if you waive that support and say, no, I don't want it, generally, you can't come back later and ask for it, okay?
So can I just maybe jump in and add parenthetically that what happens with a divorce is that it is, you know, it's a lot of acrimony. It can be a lot of acrimony for people, a lot of back and forth. By the time they get to the end of it, which is a decree, and Deborah's not talked about it yet, but it's a decree. It's like a court order. But in all theory, it is supposed to be like a roadmap for where you've been, which is dividing up all of the assets and the property and all of that stuff, and where you're going. And so let's say the children are 15 and 14 at the time you get divorced. And then, so you have a roadmap, how it's gonna work for the next 3 or 4 years. And or including if they're going to college, because right. then we work, you know, you work that out as well. And so, in theory, this roadmap is supposed to guide the parties so that when the roadmap is solidified, which means a judge's signature on it, this becomes sort of, you know, the Bible of how, for lack of a better phrase than a good phrase for a marriage or for a divorce, but it, you know, it becomes the way that it's supposed to work between them as you go forward.
Right. Okay. Thank you, Ellie, for that clarification. And that that's absolutely true because, you know, again, for a lot of reasons, the court doesn't want to just deal with something until next year and then have people have to come back. You know, we want to be able to establish a plan and hopefully one that can work out and not have a lot of disputes and conflict that ultimately is going to generally negatively affect the child. But despite that roadmap, sometimes things change, situations change. And so it is not unusual for people to come back. If it was a judgment and decree, as Ellie said, in a divorce situation, then we would call it a post-decree modification. And this, we're on page 3 there. And I love this. Divorces can be like the bad gift that keeps on giving. So, you know, if people, the more acrimonious people are, the more they tend to come back to court. And it's so sad for so many reasons, including that, I mean, if people are paying lawyers for this, then, you know, that money isn't there for the family, for whatever, or for the child, it's going out the window, and it's really quite unfortunate. But people can come back and ask for modifications. They can also come back and ask for, in a non-divorce situation, they can ask for a change in custody, they can ask for a change in parenting time, they can ask for a change in child support. Those are all done a little bit differently, and I'll just briefly talk about each one. A change of custody, and this would be either custody that was ordered after a divorce or establishment of custody. There are 13 factors in the statute for that the judge has to consider when deciding to change custody. So people who are asking for a change of custody have to address all of those factors. And again, basically, it's all what's in the best interest of the child. But, you know, what's going on that makes this so necessary? You know, what are you doing that is going to be creating a better situation for the child? You know, who else is involved? I mean, there's all kinds of things that have to be considered. It is not easy to change custody. And unless it has been at least a year since custody was determined, do not expect, unless there's something really, you know, really emergency, you know, dad's become a heroin addict and, you know, he's incarcerated, well, you might need to, or he's in treatment, you might, you know, need an emergency change of custody. But just, I'm just not happy with this. And I was just in court 2 months ago, and I knew it wasn't going to work, and it's still not working. You're not going to be able to go back to court and ask for a change of custody. Got to wait at least a year, and then you better be able to address all those 13 factors. Parenting time, as I said, people can come back to court for, it's called parenting time assistance. Basically, again, you're asking for the court to get involved in helping you resolve this, but the court's going to make you mediate it before they're going to let you actually have a hearing. Child support is something that can be changed. Again, you don't change child support, you don't ask for a change in child support just because it's really bugging you that you got to pay this amount. If you've been ordered to pay a certain amount, or from the receiving end, the other party's been ordered to pay a certain amount, unless there's a significant change in circumstances, the court isn't going to changed that amount of child support. However, we know in life, and particularly in the last few years, people have lost their jobs, people have had to take jobs that, you know, at a much lower level of income, and so, and as a child ages, they get more expensive generally, and so, or the child is having emotional problems and needs some sort of therapy, or, you know, there's things that can happen that can change, that are legitimate reasons to ask for a change in child support. Yes.
When did they change it that they base it on both of parents' income for child support?
I think it was 3 years ago that change came.
So the cases that came prior to that, do they stay the same or do they?
They are based, any change in child support is now based on this child support calculator, so all the factors that go in. If someone doesn't come back, if they were ordered to pay, you know, $400 a month,
right,
8 years ago, and they never ask for a change, and the other party doesn't ask for a change, mm-hmm, that might just continue.
Okay.
It doesn't automatically get recalculated, but if they do, you know, come back, it would be calculated in a different way, which could have a significant impact, you know, on either side. The only thing that automatically happens is, I think it's every 2 years, there's something called a cost of living adjustment, a COLA adjustment, mm-hmm, that happens automatically. And I think this year, I don't remember well enough, but I think it was pretty significant amount. I think it was maybe 4%.
Or lower, a raise with cost of living?
Well, I've never seen the cost of living go down.
Okay.
So probably the child support would not go down.
Okay.
So. As a result of that. But it could go down as a result of a change of circumstances. It can also be, the word's escaping me, but temporarily stopped,
mm-hmm,
if a person is unemployed and they're doing their level best to find employment, but or they're incarcerated or something, so that this, when it's just impossible for it to happen, that they don't get this big arrearage. But if people don't ask for it to be stopped during that time, they will be accumulating that arrearage.
You know, I just have to say my opinion.
Go for it.
Because I feel like if you're a parent, I mean, I have a friend that's going through this right now. And if she has the child all the time, to me, that's the work. You know, and just because she may make more money than the father, to me, that's so unfair, you know, because she's only getting pennies, basically, for child support, and she's the one, I mean, basically giving up her life, because now she doesn't have the partner to help her, you know, so
And I agree with you that there can be times when it seems inequitable,
mm-hmm,
and, you know, the idea with basing it, and you may have been out of the room when we talked about this, I'm not sure, that it's based on not only both incomes, but also how much time each party spends with the child.
Mm-hmm.
So if dad isn't exercising any parenting time,
mm-hmm,
you know, it's possible she could ask for his child support to be increased.
Mm-hmm.
You know, whether what the particular situation would be, or, you know, if it would go the way she wanted it to go or not, I don't know, but it might be worth asking if there's been a change in circumstances. Oh, thanks.
You know, and I would add, if I could, is that, you know, one of the rules about courts generally,
mm-hmm,
but particularly about family law, is there is, you know, people think that everything will be fair and it'll all work out in the end. Many times, there is no fairness,
right,
okay? And there is a winner and there's a loser. Regardless of, you know, regardless of how it may appear to be fair to the court system, the parties may not think it's fair. And so, and that, I think, raises an important point that when your callers are calling,
mm-hmm,
and you're speaking to them, you know, they're caught up in this whole whirlwind of a life change that many of them did not expect and many do not want. And so I think that it's important I mean, you're only going to have 5 minutes with them, but I think it's important to emphasize to them that, yes, this is going to be an emotional time for you, and yes, this is going to be a time where it just really, really, really sucks. Thank you.
That's what I was thinking, too.
Well, we're on camera, but I think that's the right phrase. You know, and so not that any of you are going to be called upon to be social workers, but I think that what this does reinforce is that when your callers are calling for legal referrals, that we want to make sure that you couple it with a social service referral for some counseling, somebody that they can, you know, and we're talking both male and female callers. I mean, I know you're getting male callers that are saying, I can't believe she's doing this to me, you know, that type of thing. And they need, you know, men need counseling too. You know, even though they'll, most of them won't admit it. Okay, go ahead, sorry.
Is there a threshold amount that for which too little, like if I were to modify child support, it would only lower $45. Is that considered not substantial, or is there an amount, or is there?
So the question is, repeating for the video, that is there a threshold amount that the child support would have to change in order to be able to ask for it? And I wish Mary were here because she's more knowledgeable about that. Yesterday, one of my colleagues was here with me. I don't think so, Sid. If there's a significant, if you can show a significant change in the circumstances, but the end result is only $45, I think that that could still happen. And, right. You know, who's to say that that isn't the difference between right. being able to make your rent and not? Mm-hmm.
I would add, though, and I don't want to take away from what your talk is, but it's a cost-benefit analysis.
Right.
Because if you're going to try and modify, you've got a filing fee that you've got to file. If you hire a lawyer, you're going to have to pay the lawyer's fee. You know, how many years do you have left on the child support? And most importantly, well, for many people, most importantly, what anguish do you have to go through? Because now, you know, the other former spouse is now not going to be happy that you're trying to change the dynamics of the child support.
Right. There's certainly, as in anything in life, cost-benefit analysis, and I agree with you, Ellie, on that. The good news is that you don't actually have to hire a lawyer, and if
Correct.
You can't afford to pay the filing fee, you might be able to get it waived, and there's a process for doing that. And this helps me sort of segue into sort of the usual course of things.
I have a quick question.
Okay.
For anybody that has back child support for whatever reason, is there any way to apply for a dismissal of that, or
yes,
you know,
they can ask for those arrearages to be I don't remember the word they use, but waived, for it to go away. Uh-huh. In certain kinds of circumstances. So
like if they're unemployed during the time and for whatever reason they didn't for some reason let them know,
it's possible.
Is that
sort
hard?
Yes. Okay. It is hard. And very often when child support is not being paid, the custodial parent has to resort to getting assistance from the county. Mm-hmm. And the more the county is involved, I mean, they're going to fight because that's taxpayer money. They're going to say, heck no. You know, he was, or she was, because it can go the other way, voluntarily unemployed. You know, could have at least taken a job doing XYZ, but chose not to. And so, you know, so there's lots of factors there, but are there situations where someone could have that?
Well, especially just like not a person that by any means meant to be or wasn't actively looking for employment, and then they've had a great employment record afterwards and paid all of their child support payments concurrently. Can that speak for itself as like a character, you know, and have some sort of...
I don't think it's about bad intention necessarily.
Yeah.
It's about, again, what's best for this child.
Right.
What is best for this child? So it's not out of the realm of possibility, but it is not easy. And often, though, I mean, there are consequences to having arrearages on your child support. You can lose your driver's license, which certainly doesn't help you in a job search. You know, there, if you could be in contempt of court if you really didn't follow, and you could go to jail. So there, the court will always try to be realistic about what someone can afford to pay. They may say, okay, we're, you know, we won't suspend your driver's license, but you've got to pay $10 a month or 10% more than you're paying to work on those arrearages in order to be able to not have those consequences. Okay?
I have a question. How do you prove, if you want to put the child support on hold, how do you prove that you're actively seeking employment, but you just haven't been able to find it?
Good question. Milka's asking, how do you prove, if you want to put a hold on child support, that you are actively seeking employment? And there are ways to do that. You can keep a job log, and actually, if you are receiving public assistance yourself, you may be required to keep a job log. You may be required to attend some classes on how to interview or how to, you know, to be able to show that you are trying your best. And again, you know, we've got a lousy situation, a lousy economy right now, and so there are a lot of people in that situation through no fault of their own. But again, we're talking about what's best for the kid. So let me just, can someone check my time for me?
You've got about 10 to 15 minutes.
10 to 15 minutes, okay. So in the usual course, I'm on the bottom of page 3 in the handout, a lawsuit, and family law is civil law. It's a subset of civil law. So in Minnesota, and I know you guys learned this, and so I'm reminding you of this, unlike I think every other state, maybe Louisiana, which is just odd in its laws in so many ways, lawsuits...
Another country, go on.
Lawsuits start with service. They don't start with filing in the court. Okay, so if, and I, Ellie shared with me that, you know, she shared that with you, and people, you know, it was like, wow, I really, now I understand why it's so important to know this, because since the rest of the country, it starts with filing, and there'll be a court file number on papers if they're served on you. Lots of consumer advocates will say, don't be fooled by, if you get this thing that looks official, if it doesn't have a court file number, it's probably a scam, okay? Well, that might be true in the other states. That is not true here in Minnesota. So it always starts with service, whether it is someone suing you for a credit card that you didn't pay off, or suing you for divorce, or trying to establish custody and parenting time, or trying to say that you're the father of the child. Service is first. So if someone tells you, I see something and it doesn't really look right, and I even called the court, and they said, no, we don't have a filing. Well, they're not gonna have a filing until, often they won't have the filing until later, until after the service is done, and the party who started it can file their pleadings, you know, what they were filing, along with the proof that they served it. And sometimes they'll wait until after the default period, and we'll talk about that in a sec, to even do their filing. So when someone receives this and they're trying to, I mean, they're really trying to figure out, what am I supposed to do with this? It looks weird. I don't know what to do. If they call you to try to figure that out, make sure you tell them, you know, if it looks like a legal proceeding, there are places you can call to double check, but it, even though there's not a court file number on it, doesn't mean that it's not real. So err on the side of caution. Generally, what they will receive, if it's the beginning of a lawsuit or dissolution or any of these things that we're talking about, there'll be something called a summons on the front. And the summons will tell the person how long they have to respond. And in a divorce situation, it's 30 days in Minnesota. In some other parts of family law, it's only 20 days. In an order for protection, it's only 10 days. The general civil lawsuit, it is 20 days. So if they don't respond in writing and keep a copy of it, it's possible that the other side is going to get exactly what they asked for, because that would be called a default. And if the court doesn't, you know, if the other party, if you can't prove that you served the other party with a response or an answer, and again, this might still not have been filed at court. So if I'm the one who started this and I serve Kendra and she doesn't respond after 20 days, I'm going to go to the courthouse, or actually now we're in the midst of something called e-filing, where we're becoming a paperless court. You know, I would submit to the court what I served her, proof that I served her. I'd pay my filing fee unless I'd gotten a waiver of the filing fee from a judge. And I would be saying, I'd also file an affidavit of default. She didn't respond. So I'm asking you, court, to order, to give me everything I asked for in my pleadings. And I will probably get it, unless Kendra jumps up and says, wait, I didn't understand, and has a very good reason for it. So please tell people to be aware of when they received that document, okay? We're going to talk just in a minute about service a little bit more. When they receive the document, and then it is 20 days or 30 days that starts. Day one is the day after they received it, okay? So,
Debra, how formal does that answer have to be? Can I just shoot them a letter?
You can, and you can, as long as you keep a copy of it, and you also keep, and the question was, I'm sorry, how formal does the answer have to be? Ideally, it would be in a format that the court actually provides, and there are those forms on the court's website, answer to a divorce, there's an answer to a civil lawsuit. Ideally, it would be that way, because you would address all of the issues there. But it can be as simple as a letter that you keep a copy of, so important, and you provide proof that you served it properly. And so, remember I said that initially things have to be served, I guess I didn't say this, but they have to be, if you're starting the lawsuit, it has to be personal service. So what does it mean to be personally served? Personal service means that someone, not the other party, because it can never be by the other party, could be the sheriff, could be a process server, could be just some third neutral party. It could be a relative or family member, although it's always best if it's
not,
because you open yourself up to, didn't really do it.
Yeah.
Okay, but so what has to happen is someone has to hand it. So I would hand it to Shatana and say, here. And she would go, ew, I don't want it. But I could fill out an affidavit of personal service, which is a notarized statement that says, I swear that on October 26th, 2012 at 1:40, whatever it is, I handed this to Shatana at this location. I could also go to Amy's house and I could, and someone would answer the door and say, nope, Amy's not here right now, she's at work. Well, who are you, do you live here? Well, yes, I'm her roommate, or I'm her husband, or I'm her adult child, or whatever. Okay, here, give this to Amy. And I can then do the affidavit, that's called substitute service, but that is okay too.
That's shady.
Well, it's not shady. It's because it's in the court rules. So hopefully Amy's roommate, husband, adult child would say, oh, Amy, look what came for you today.
They have to get their name of who they're handing it to?
They are supposed to, but if the person won't give them their name, they can put John Doe, Jane Doe. Then they'll put a little physical description. And believe me, I've had so many people say, this affidavit is a lie. You know, I don't live with anybody. You know, I don't know who was at my house, but I don't believe it. I just don't believe it. Well, I'll be honest with you, if it's the sheriff who did the service, yeah, it's going to be hard to say that they're lying. But if it's not, so if it's your brother who did the service,
right,
you know, maybe you'd be open to the suggestion. Maybe the judge would believe, nope, it really never happened. That's all just a lie. So,
can
yes.
Can you have them get, like, photographic evidence? Like, here, click, there you go.
I haven't seen that, but I would imagine that process service might do that. They just might do that.
Sheriff's, like, isn't that, like, a bothersome thing for them, for, like, you to go to the sheriff's office and be like, I need you to serve this? Like, do they really want to deal with any of that?
Well,
good
question.
Are they beholden to, or?
Well, they charge.
Okay.
And they charge people about $70 to $100, depends how far they have to go, depends how many trips they have to make. Is that fine?
You get about five more minutes.
Okay. But if you can't afford that fee, you might be able to get that waived by the judge. But otherwise, they're going to charge for it. Do they like to do it? I don't know. It's part of their job.
Yeah, I just wanted to know if that was part of their
absolutely
job description, and if
yep
they were beholden to do something like that.
Yeah, it's one of the things that they do. And they have, all sheriffs and all over the country have a civil unit, mm-hmm, civil process unit. So that's part of what they regularly do. I'm aware that our time is running away quickly, so I want to make sure I cover a couple of things.
Make sure you talk about this.
And I will. Yes, I will. So the written materials on family court in general, these are the basics. I understand you're going to get another session that you can get more into the nitty-gritty. But I hope that this is helpful as an outline. There are a lot of places that you can refer people to for more help. Jillian and Ellie did a great job of listing a number of those. One of them, I'm proud to say, is the Self-Help Center. And so I think you all have a little PowerPoint sort of handout. We'd hoped to use the PowerPoint, but that didn't work out. Is really focused on the 4th District, Hennepin County, which is where I work. We have two self-help centers there, and one of them is just for family law. And so please do feel free to refer people there. And in fact, people who are representing themselves, we call them pro se litigants for oneself, not in divorces and not in most child support modification motions, but all other motions, they have to come to the self-help center and get their forms reviewed by someone on staff there. And so that's a big part of what we do. And the reason for that is twofold. One, it's to make sure that people are doing it right so that they don't get surprised. But it's also to make sure that the court runs efficiently, because when people don't have a resource to go to, you know, their concept of what's involved might be very far from the actual reality. But we also have a self-help center for non-family law matters as well. And between the two of them this year, we're going to have about close to 40,000 people walking in to those self-help centers. So I have a great staff in both locations that care, and they're smart, and they're going to help people as best they can. In addition, there is a virtual self-help center that is available for anyone in any county in Minnesota. So if you're talking to people in Anoka or other places that don't have the walk-in self-help centers, I have staff attorney colleagues who answer phones and respond to emails, and they will actually review forms, via email for people, and they're really, really helpful as well. The handout also shows that we have some courthouse clinics where wonderful volunteer lawyers come and give free, brief legal advice to people on a variety of topics. So Please take a look at that. And those green bookmarks, I just, you know, self-promoting, but we've taken a lot of time and continue to update. There's a lot of basic legal information on the court's website and links to a lot of other resources. And so really try to get familiar with it yourself if you aren't already, and refer your callers to it, because they can do a lot of things virtually, like watch those child support modification videos and figure out how to do that without ever having to leave their home. So thanks for your attention. Again, it's a thrill to be here, and thank you so much for the important work that you do every day.
And thank you, Debra, for a great presentation. All right, now we're back on, and I just want to emphasize a couple things that Debra spoke about, and then just make some direct references to our referrals. Once again, we see how some of our prior trainings are coming back, because last month we talked about youth law and what's the guiding principle in youth law, what is in the best interest of the child. So we hear that again with family law. Even though the parents may be duking it out with each other, if there are children involved, what the court's going to do is always look out for what is in the child's best interest. And that comes in terms of the custodial arrangement for the child. Custody is just like not a really great word, you know. It sounds like you own something. But the arrangement where the child will live, who will provide for the child's well-being in terms of income, in terms of health care, in terms of college expenses, education expenses. So again, we dovetail back to what our prior training was, and I'm so thrilled that we can continue to have things that are overlapping. And I talked a little bit ago about how emotional these divorces are, and I'm sure that some of you are getting callers that are extremely angry, callers that are crying, callers that are lost. And I think that, and all of you have been trained very well, so I don't want to interrupt with that training, but I think that it's okay, to the extent you can give them a minute and let them just vent and just let them speak, you know, that may go a long way for some people. And I would assume that after their relatives and after their friends, you're the next place that many of these callers are calling. And most of our callers here are going to be low income, because the ones that can afford the, oh my God, $300 or $400 an hour lawyers have got that reference through the, whatever their network is. So not that all lawyers are that expensive, and there are some, and we'll get to them, which are low bono and doing low fee. The other thing that I wanted to emphasize, and by the way, family law is an area that I actually did practice in when I was a practicing attorney. So I've gotten a 6 o'clock in the morning phone call from somebody saying, you know, I'm thinking of slitting my wrists. You know, not that they were going to do that, but, you know, I'm familiar with some of the emotion involved with it. Not to say the least, I've been through a divorce, but we won't go there. But I think that it is important that we also emphasize and remember it is a process for people who are going through divorce. So for many of your callers, they're going to be somewhere along some kind of a plane. They're either going to be going up because maybe they're in favor of the divorce, or they're going to be going down because they don't want it. And I think that, as we know, it's just human nature. Things are with divorce, with family law, are up and down, up and down. And before it starts to settle out, it could be a 2-year or a 3-year process. And for some relationships, it never settles out, because there's always some issue, something that's eating at them, and there's always some pain involved. So I don't think that it hurts for you to remind your callers that they're in for a process. It's a process. It's not an event. It's not, you know, well, we're going to get a divorce and everything is fine. It's just, it's a process that we all have to go through as human beings. And lastly, with mediation, the great thing about mediation is that while it requires that there's some give here and some give here, at the end, assuming you agree, you have some ownership to what it is that you've resulted in. If you go in front of a judge, You have somebody who does not know you, has actually no connection to your life whatsoever, making decisions that are so fundamentally important to your life. Now, of course, if your callers say, should I mediate it or should I, you know, go to court, that's something we leave to their legal counsel, all right? But certainly the idea, the word mediation, is an important word for people to hear right essentially from the beginning of their divorce process, because it's, for many people, it's how the divorce ends. And I think that, I know from my personal experience as an attorney that I've never had anyone ever tell me, geez, I'm really glad I let the judge decide it, and it came out a lot better than I could have had a role in trying to shape through a settlement. So that's just, you know, some background. Okay, now let's go to the referrals, because on pages 5 through 8, we have a number of different referrals. We've broken them down by county. What's my time? Thank you. And so let's go through them. And again, these are all low or moderate income caller referrals. The Family Court Self-Help Center has a legal clinic that the VLN staffs. And they're there every day of the week at different times, but it is important to, maybe they're not there on Wednesdays, that's my fault. But it's important to tell your callers that that the good news is there are lawyers there that are there to help them. The bad news is they have to be patient and they're gonna need to get there early. All right, because there's going to be a line, they're going to need to wait. So it's all a trade-off. But nonetheless, they get some advice. Now, they don't get representation. The attorney's not going to take on the case, although there are some instances where the cases will be referred out. But they will at least have the ability to speak to a lawyer. Likewise, the VLN also, on the top of page 6, they have a family law phone advice system. Where the callers will be able to, within a two-hour window, get a call back from a VLN lawyer. Now, it's only 20 minutes worth of advice. Again, though, it's better than no advice. And that's really what we're trying to do with the system. We're trying to do a system where there aren't enough attorneys servicing low-income people, so we're trying to do the next best thing by giving them some advice, giving them some perspective and some help, and sending them on their way, and hopefully they can make their way, and if they can't, they're gonna have to come back and get advice in some other form. Legal aid, Minnesota legal aid item number 3, will provide full representation where there's a custody issue or where there's an issue about domestic abuse. And so, but that's at 125% of federal poverty guidelines. Of course, you know, if the caller is close to that, certainly make sure that we refer them. But as we've indicated in the red print, we want to always, on all of these, but particularly with legal aid, because legal aid is so overwhelmed, make sure that we are giving them fallback referrals. Our fallback referrals being the court self-helps, so the family law court self-help centers in either Hennepin or in Ramsey, or lawhelpmn.org. or the self-help center, the statewide court self-help center. All right. Now, moving on to what would be low bono. So this would be low fee, not, so for people who have some ability to afford, would be the Hennepin County Bar Association Low Fee Project. We've talked about this before. I do want to report back that the folks at Hennepin County doing their low bono, their low fee family law project, told me that as of the beginning of October, they had already received more calls as of that date than they had had of all of last year. And some of that undoubtedly is attributable to 211 making better targeted referrals. So you guys get an add a person. Way to go. So thank you. All right. All right. Item number 5, Cooper and Reed, which you cannot make direct referrals to, but has a low fee, sliding fee schedule based on income for their family law clients. Now remember, what we will do is we will refer those to the alternative 211 referral button on our website, okay? And who's here been referring people to our website? Raise your hand. Okay, Kelly gets a gold star. Okay, remember, we have a website. It has many, many resources. Do not ordinarily refer them to call us because we're not doing direct referrals, but certainly refer them to the website because all of the resources that we have listed here are on the website as well. In addition, they can access the training material that you are looking at right now. And they can access this video. So, hey, if you're a caller, you can see me. So, you know, I mean, so it's important. Refer them to the Call for Justice website. Okay. And the Father's Project for Dads, which I'm sure you're getting some calls for, operated through Central Minnesota Legal Services, but it'll be the same number as number 3 up above, 612-334-5570. So refer dads there. Over in Ramsey County, over on the Ramsey County side of the river, they have a family court self-help center as well. And so make sure that you're referring your callers there. And they also have pro se clinics, as I've indicated here in the written materials, 3 days a week. I am told that there are 2 lawyers at those clinics, and they will see 4 people each. Each lawyer will see 4 people each clinic day. So 8 people can get served with those clinics. So we're back to show up early, or call and make an appointment, and be patient. All right. And I think the great thing about the Ramsey County Family Court Pro Se Clinic is that there are no income eligibility requirements. So they will take anyone. They'll take anybody of any income. So again, great point. Ramsey County Bar Association has a low fee service, just like the Hennepin County service does. So refer people there. Smurls is taking clients as well, although I had limited information about eligibility because I always like to look at more than what's on their website. And if we get more information, when we do, we'll share it with you guys. Now, for the Twin Cities generally, all right, Tubman, I think, is doing some phenomenal work. And as you can see that what Tubman is doing is they're making for people that are 125% or less, they will do full rep. But for people that are 250% or less, they will give them 2 hours of time with a lawyer. That, in my view, is huge, and that's a phenomenal asset. And so make people aware of that again, back to that patience thing, and they'll need to call and make an appointment. But we have the Dakota County Law Library, Anoka County. Both of them are offering pro se assistance. And item 4 under Twin Cities generally, the Cornerstone Divorce Preparation Classes. I've got to tell you, this is something that we found out recently through our liaison program. And I've got to tell you, I think that this is a phenomenal resource for our community. It is a course taught for pre-divorce people. So if you're contemplating it, not like everyone is willing to admit they're contemplating it, but it's a place that you can refer people to who are pre-divorce or in the process of divorce for them to learn more nuts and bolts about what to expect. So remember I talked about that roadmap? It is extremely important for somebody, I believe, to sit down and explain to you, this is what you can expect, this is what's going to happen next, and after that, this is what's going to happen, and then you're going to get to this, then you're going to get to that, and then finally, after all of this heartache and fighting and whatever else, but not every divorce is that way, so after all of this time or whatever, you'll finally be at this point where you get a decree and you're officially legally divorced. So Cornerstone, I think, is a place to start sending people who are callers, regardless of where they are in the divorce process. I think it's a tremendous, at least, fallback referral, tremendous secondary referral. And they're open to accepting people from across the Twin Cities. They are not holding the classes every month. They're every other month. And so your callers are going to need to call and make sure that they've got a place for them at Cornerstone.
Do they help men?
You know, I think they do. Okay. I believe that they do. I at least on the materials that I saw, and I can, if you email me about that, Mary, I will double back and confirm that. But from the materials I saw, it did not say it was restricted to women.
Who puts the classes on? Is it attorneys or?
It's attorneys. Oh. Attorneys. They're. I think they're. They have. They double team the class. They have two attorneys, and if I'm wrong on that, I know it's at least one attorney. Yes. In fact, they've asked us as Call for Justice with our liaison program to see if we can elicit other attorneys for their classes. So their next class is January. All right. But I think it's a tremendous community resource. So, and then we have the Minnesota Court Self-Help Center and lawhelpmn.org has materials about divorces. Of course, you know, we have some callers that don't have access to computers, some callers that are not caller savvy. Although Debra did say yesterday, and we did not hear today, but if they call the self-help center, they actually have the ability, the Minnesota State Court Self-Help Center, they have the ability to actually, Julian, what did they call it? To follow on the their computer screen with the caller's computer screen. And remember, the callers can go to the courthouse. Every courthouse has a computer and has a telephone. And so they can connect to the centralized self-help center, which is in Hennepin, but will deal with any county in the state. But they have the ability in Hennepin to be looking at the computer screen as well as the caller looking at the computer screen, and they can guide the caller to what documents they need. Okay, so it sounds like a very good arrangement. So now that gets us to Zoe. Okay, poor Zoe is now starting down the road of a divorce. And next session, which will be in January, we will not be back until January, but our next session, we will bring in divorce lawyers. Debra and Mary from yesterday, they work within the court system, and certainly they're attorneys, but they're not in the trenches doing divorce work regularly. So what this session was for introducing concepts to you. The next session will be with divorce lawyers talking a little bit more nuanced about some things. Not that we're trying to make you divorce lawyers, but we're certainly trying to make you more aware of what your callers are facing. So this month's referral help for Zoe really is, let's get her familiar with what that roadmap is and what that process is. So that's why we've suggested a referral to Cornerstone or to the Court Self-Help Center if that's not going to work. Okay, well, that's pretty much what we have for our introduction to family law. Does anybody have any questions? Yes.
I have a very loose concept floating around in my head. And
I have many of those.
Okay, well, it's based on a phone call that I got last night from a woman who had gone through child protection proceedings and lost custody of her children. And, you know, I'm aware we have programs coded for family preservation and family reunification services, but I'm also aware that there's a lot more critical legal stuff she would have to get into before even really needing any of those programs. And, you know, I went under the custody assistance, and obviously I see some helpful referrals for her situation, like, I don't know, Hennepin County Bar Association, Family Low Fee, but it's all to go back to a case that's already been closed out. And I don't know, the likelihood of being able to find, I mean, there must be programs out there, and I guess I kind of was wishing that we had more grasp on programs for parents that maybe are trying to get their kids back after CHIPS proceedings and all of that.
Well, I think that there are a lot of factors that go into that.
Right.
One of which, I mean, remember the overriding factor is what's in the child's best interest.
Right,
so
right.
If her parental rights have been terminated, mm-hmm. you know, the issue would be what has she done to change the circumstances that have caused the parental rights to be terminated.
Exactly.
So if she had been let's assume she was a drug addict, she's gotten cleaned up.
Right.
She's been straight and clean for a year.
Right, you know, because one of the things was she was homeless, and I said, first you have to get yourself together and get a a stable environment before they would even look at you as being worthy of taking the child back.
Absolutely, yeah. Absolutely. And that's just good common sense. And then you play in with the age of the children, because, you know, the children at some point have a say about whether they're going to go back with their parents. Mm-hmm. Remember, we talked last month, you know, that 14-year-old age thing starts to be gets to be an issue where the child has a say in what happens with them. Okay. So in the specific case that you're talking about, I think if she's homeless, let's get her to a shelter and get her to a place where there might be an advocate,
right,
that can help her.
Right, like a lawyer consultation that could give her something more at length.
Absolutely.
Okay.
But for her, that caller, it's an incremental process, and a lot depends on the age of the kids.
Yeah.
If her kids are 2 or 3 years old, and she straightens out her life, and she's got a track record where it's straightened out for a couple of years,
right,
she may have a really good chance of being able to reestablish, you know, parental relationship with the children.
Right.
But if the kids are 16 years old, and by the time she straightens herself out, they're almost 18, or one,
yeah,
is it, you know, it doesn't mean that she can't have a relationship with the children at some point. It just means that she's not the legal,
right,
custodian, the legal parent of the child.
Okay.
So.
Yeah, I had a call like that, and I just referred them to visitation, supervised visitation agencies, because, yeah, there was not a chance that they're going to get custody back next week, you know.
Correct.
So as long as they can keep that connection with the child, then that helps them in the long run also, because it shows that they were participating or trying to maintain that. So, yeah, I've done that.
It's so on the telephone with what you guys have for access, the best you can do is just get them referred to some place where they can get a start.
Right, because she didn't even know who had her kids, and I was like, okay, so they must have been in a foster placement. But,
correct.
You know.
That's what I would think. Yes, Shatana.
Okay, so mediation, are there links on your website on the call for justice, or because I'm hearing mediation and then parenting advocate, so what type of how can we find who those people are?
The information for the mediators is on the court websites.
Okay.
All right. And and the parenting time assistance, that would be through the court system, how they would.
We have one or two clinics listed in RIDA for mediation.
Yeah. We've got a bunch of different services.
The Hamlin.
Like,
oh, okay.
There's Hamlin, there's the mediation center. Mm-hmm.
Yes, and yeah, you know, and probably for us in the future, getting a list of mediators together is probably a really good idea.
You mentioned parenting advocates.
That's appointed by the court.
Yeah,
that's something different. That would be like guardian at litem. The parenting consultant is appointed by the court.
Yeah, and now that would not be something that you would be referring callers to. That they get those only after they've got to go through a couple hoops in the court system, before that person would be appointed, or before they would be referred to that person.
The way that I understood it was that if the judge feels like it's a nuanced situation and couldn't accurately decide what the best interest of the child would be, mm-hmm, then the judge would say, here, go get a parenting consultant. The parenting consultant will do evaluations and decide, and then we're going to follow that.
Yeah, I heard that. That's what I'm saying.
If someone called us
and said, hey, the judge said, I need a parenting consultant, I just was wondering
where
you
we
would
go.
You would refer them back to the courts because they should have been given a listing of options.
Yeah. That would be my impression, that they would get a list from the court system, because these are people that are certified through the courts to make those decisions. And the judges, I mean, there are private psychologists and social workers that can get hired by parties when they start their divorce, and they can make recommendations about how they think it should go. But this parenting advocate, what Debra was talking about, is somebody the court recognizes as somebody that's going to be able to make a decision for the parties that the court will accept. these private people, when people start with divorces, like the social workers or the psychologists, they're paid experts. Right. You know, you've heard the phrase hired guns. You know, so they come in, their testimony is weighed, but it doesn't necessarily meet control.
Mm-hmm. And this, the one that she keeps mentioning is only recognized by the court, and that's the one that they have screened. They have said, you know, here's what we're expecting you to look at in determining what's best for the child. Mm-hmm. So these are the only agencies that you can go to. You can't go find your own.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I think we would have gotten calls about...
Yeah,
I've never received a caller saying, I need a parenting consultant. And I feel like if we were going to get calls and that was our job to refer that, I would have.
Right.
I've been here 8 years. I would have gotten at least one call about that.
So, all right. Any other questions? All right. Well, thank you guys very much for your attention and great questions, as always. We were thrilled to do it, and we will see you in January for the second installment of Family Law.
Thank you.
Thank you. You're welcome.